Tasha's Cauldron of Everything. To everything? To everything. Tasha's Cauldron is out, and we've got a ton of new subclasses for our Dungeons & Dragons 5th Edition games to sort through and criticize and drool over and argue about. And well, I'm a nerd at heart. So needless to say, I've spent this past week or so poring over the new goodies to see what's good, what's great, and what's more along the lines of meh. So today I thought I would round up the 5 best new subclasses out of Tasha's and bring them to you in a little ranking. Now I know some of these we've seen before in UA, or really most of them, or even in another book when it comes to the Bladesinger, but nevertheless, I've narrowed these down to the absolute best that Tasha's Cauldron has to offer, and you can rest assured that there is absolutely no, none, zero, zilch, nada, no subjectivity to my opinions here, clearly. I'll throw an Amazon link down below to Tasha's if you haven't picked up a copy for yourself yet, but if you have, this is the part of the video where you pause and see how close you get to the final 5, okay? On your marks, get set, go. Starting off our top 5 ranking, we have maybe my favorite new subclass when it comes to outright flavor, the Rogue Phantom. Yes, I love this class for all of its dead spirity goodness and its Haley Joel Osment-esque dark whisperings. I love the implied Shatterkai tie-ins in the background text as well, and overall theme. It's just solid. But that's not why it made the list here at number 5. That's because this class is downright nasty. Right off the bat, we get 2 of the better abilities in all of Tasha's, Whispers of the Dead and Wails from the Grave, with Whispers being both a strong mechanical ability as well as flavorful and good in the roleplay part of the game as well. And we get the core engine to the Phantom with Wails to really let your class get off to a fast start of feeling like the subclass right away. While the next ability doesn't come until level 9, Tokens of the Departed is my favorite ability in Tasha's. It basically lets you snatch part of people's departing soul in a very reminiscent way to the Bard College of Whispers. And what makes Tokens so great is its flexibility, something that will be a bit of a theme here in this video. If you manage to make it to level 13, Ghostwalk is an absolute bomb, and our level 17 Death's Friend is still decent even if it's a teeny bit underwhelming. At least it's useful, which not everything is this late in the game. Overall, the Phantom is excellent, and might be the class that I try out next personally. Definitely worthy of this spot. Coming in at number 4, we leave the Rogue behind for a little Cleric. Now, if I'm being perfectly honest, all 3 of the domains we got in Tasha's are great. In fact, I was having a conversation with my brother and we even talked a bit about how most, if not all, of the cleric subclasses across the game are really extremely well put together. But for me, there was one that just stood out a bit more than the others here, and that's the Peace domain. If I had to pick a sleeper class for being underrated, it would definitely be the Peace domain cleric. Right off the bat, we get an absolute bomb in Emboldening Bond, which, while limited to a number of targets equal to your proficiency modifier, is just outright game changing. It just is. Being able to throw a non-concentrating once per round per target bless that stacks with an actual bless is ridiculous. Just that right there for a level 6 party who has a Peace domain cleric with Emboldening Bond and bless up at the same time is crazy. Throw in a paladin with an aura of protection and your group can just about walk right up to a CR 13 Atropaw without even flinching. And again, it's all about flexibility. Just having the flexibility to use the bonus d4s as each target wants without concentration from the party's cleric is incredible. At 2nd level, that's followed up with, in my opinion, the single best channel in the game now. Being able to move 30 feet to get to a dying teammate without provoking is so, so good. We've all seen fights where the party needs to get a healer in place to heal someone making death saves, but they end up taking either a massive attack themselves off of an opportunity attack, or they've even dropped themselves during said attack. This is an excellent ability. I mean, every single ability this subclass gets ranges from good to incredible. Protective Bond, excellent from both a mechanical standpoint and a game design standpoint, with providing players options in combat. Potent spellcasting is pretty good, and expansive bond makes your good things just that much better. I really don't understand why people are not more excited about this subclass. It's remarkable and easily one of the best that Tasha's has to offer. Moving on to number 3, we have a new subclass from one of my least favorite subclasses, just to show people that I don't play favorites, the Fathomless Warlock. I genuinely enjoyed the tentacly flavor of this subclass, and when I say immediately this thing is a superstar in combat, I mean it's a superstar. Tentacles of the Deep turns your character into a Gatling gun, and you get to trigger it a number of times per day equal to your proficiency bonus, so just about every single round of every single fight you'll go through. And Gifts of the Sea is just cool. I love abilities that are good outside of combat and occasionally good during combat. And this fits right in. If I was running a campaign and someone wanted to play a Fathomless Warlock, without a doubt, somewhere in that campaign, I'm throwing an Aboleth just so this player gets to shine. I mean, I love using Aboleths anyways, but now I won't have to feel as guilty. You know what I'm saying? Now, while resistance to cold damage from Oceanic Coil isn't as flashy as some abilities, it's still mildly decent, and Guardian Coil at level 6 is just downright great. Meanwhile, you follow that up at level 10 with an Everard's Black Tentacles that triggers temp hit points like an Abjurer Wizard, and a super slick ability at 14 with Fathomless Plunge that lets you teleport around in pools of water. And yes, you only teleport up to a mile, admittedly, but the utility here is still great. I know for a fact my Out of the Abyss players wish they could have bounced around the Dark Lake in the Underdark and away from the insert spoiler here that was destroying insert spoiler here. Overall, a great design with a big punch of flavor. The Fathomless Warlock is a wonderful new subclass for you out there that want to call upon the Big Daddy Kraken to be your patron of choice. Which brings us to our runner-up for the new Tasha's subclasses, and that prestigious award goes to none other than the Oath of the Watchers Paladin. Now, I have two things I want to say about this subclass right away. First off, it's excellent, okay, right? Second off, even though this class feels a little more specific with its abilities than I usually like, it's still so good that it overcomes that issue for me. I want to start with its spell list for a moment. Typically, I don't put much stock into subclass spell lists anyways, especially so for the Paladin, because I like to save my spells for smites. I know not everyone does, but I do. However, if you are going to give me some extra spells, give me utility, and boy, does this subclass get some utility with Alarm, Detect Magic, See Invisibility, Counterspell, and Banishment. Excellent, excellent choices here, even if Counterspell doesn't come to us until the 9th level. Moving on to the channels, we get Watcher's Will and a seemingly specific Abjure the Extra Planar. Now, Abjure hits Aberrations, Celestials, Elementals, Fey, and Fiends, and hits them with a wisdom save to not be turned. At first, you might think that's a little bit too narrow, but frankly, you might end up being surprised based on the campaign specifically. Just how many of those types of monsters you end up facing over the course of a 10 to 12 level campaign. If you're playing in an epic campaign, the rates at which you're going to encounter those things is going to increase exponentially. So while it might look meh on the surface, this ability will get used. For Watcher's Will, giving the party an advantage on saving throws against half of the abilities is kind of the opposite. It looks maybe better than it is during play because so few spells or abilities are going to target players with intelligence saves or charisma saves. Though, advantage on wisdom saves is powerful, there is no doubt. Now, as we move on to the aura at level 7, we get to give our proficiency bonus to everybody within range on their initiative rolls. Let me put it to you frankly, this is a bomb. There are maybe one or maybe two auras that I can think of for the Paladin that are even close to being on par with how great this one is. And while it may not seem to be as sexy as Psychic Rogues, it will, without a doubt, turn the tides of a few key fights during a campaign that might have gone very badly for the party without it. Dungeons & Dragons 5e is all about action economy. And if your group gets to go first and remove action economy before it even happens, you've probably already won. Vigilant Rebuke at level 15 is fine. Not the most amazing ability, but very usable, and perhaps usable multiple times during an encounter even. And Mortal Bulwark at 20, I mean, let's be honest. Does it even matter? If I said to you, you win the game or you lose the game at this level, it wouldn't matter. Nobody plays with level 20 characters that isn't really a one-shot in my experience. I mean, let's be honest. It is, by the way, very good for epic level adventuring, just for the record. And so that brings us to our final slot with the absolute best, undeniably magnificent, stone cold winner of the best subclass for Tasha's Cauldron, the Psy Warrior Fighter. I think it's great to see the fighter up here because frankly, in my opinion, it needs it a bit. While it's true fighters can be some of the most interesting characters in combat with a few notable exceptions, they often feel a little stiff. Move up, attack things hard, occasionally action surge. But the Psy Warrior is the king of options, and the options are all pretty damn good. For those of you who don't know, I've published my very own 5th edition class, which is available on DriveThruRPG in the link down below called the Mistwalker. And it is an entire class, not just a fighter subclass. Now, I might be a little biased here, but the overall design of the Psy Warrior gave me a lot of the same vibes. When I read the Psionic Strike and looked at what is essentially an intelligence-based fighter type with a lot of flexibility, instead of move up and hit X thing with a big sword, I really liked the game design that I saw there. Now, mechanically, the Psy Warrior plays much more akin to the Battlemaster with its psionic energy dice, but with just more interesting choices, in my opinion. Instead of being pigeonholed to different forms of attack, like the Battlemaster with the distracting strike, disarming attack, goading attack, grappling strike, lunging attack, maneuvering attack, menacing attack, precision attack, pushing attack, and so on. You guys get it. The Psy Warrior has a better depth of choice in how they want to utilize their psionic dice, even with only an initial pool of just three choices. The class plays with an emphasis on movement and positioning and runs on the engine of dealing damage with its psionic strike if all you want to do is to convert your dice into more damage. Now, by the time the class reaches 10th level, Guarded Mind is admittedly a bit weak, let's be honest. But if you do end up playing to a higher level, Bulwark of Force and Telekinetic Master are still both solid abilities that open up your action economy to take advantage of your bonus action. Overall, the flavor, interesting design, solid mechanics, and solid power levels of the abilities in this subclass were enough to just put it over the top to claim that top spot as the best new official subclass for 5th edition, even if maybe the Fathomless Warlock or even the Spore Druid might spit out more damage per round. Now I want to know, where did I go wrong? What new classes got snubbed? And which did I rate just way too high to be on this list? Let me know in the argument section down below. Oh, and also, let me know if you agreed with my picks. Sometimes I feel like I say that, like, let me know what I did wrong. And you guys are like, oh, here's what you did wrong. So if you think that I did nail a couple of these, you know, maybe let me know that too. I, of course, want to give a massive thank you to all the incredible patrons out there over at WelcomeAdventures.com. Guys, thank you so much for all of your amazing support. In fact, earlier today, we just did our monthly hangouts. We had quite a few people in there talking about games and mechanics and Pathfinder 2 and my personal feelings on those. So thank you guys so much for all the support. If you guys like what I do here, you want to support more content like this, WelcomeAdventures.com is a great place to support the channel and snag some rewards for yourself. If this is your first time here and you love role-playing games as much as I do, I would love to have you subscribe. I put out videos on GM tips, player tips, tutorials, and more. So if that sounds like something you might be interested in, just hit that subscribe button down below and come join us. Thank you guys so much for watching. My name is Cody, and as always, may your games be filled with awesome memories and even better friends. I'll catch you guys next time.
Yeah.